So there is blood vessel, and the inner lining of the blood vessel composed of endothelial cells that are located on a basement membrane. And if damage to endothelial cells occurs and the inner lining of the blood vessel becomes disrupted, organism has to immediately cover and repair the damaged area. And the specific mechanism that helps to repair the damage to the blood vessel wall called hemostasis. The major principle of hemostasis is to seal the hole in the inner lining of the blood vessel as fast as possible. For this purpose, our clotting system forms thrombus. Hemostasis can be divided into distinct stages, primary and secondary. The general concept is that once damage to the inner lining occurred, the goal here is to immediately seal the hole. In order to do this, platelets immediately interact with the blood vessel wall, and this results in formation of a platelet plaque. But because coagulation system makes platelet plaque as fast as possible, platelet plaque is still a bit rough around the edges. And because platelet plaque is weak, we have to stabilize it. And in order to stabilize it, we have secondary hemostasis that makes from weak platelet plaque a formidable thrombus. Now about primary and secondary hemostasis in details. Let's begin with primary hemostasis. The first step in primary hemostasis is rapid transient vasoconstriction. When the damage to endothelial cell occurs and the inner lining of the blood vessel becomes disrupted, in response to this, blood vessel rapidly constricts. Transient vasoconstriction caused by a combination of factors. First of all, by neural stimulation, and also by endothelin that is contained inside the endothelial cells. Because when damage to endothelial cell occurs, this disruption of the endothelial cells, endothelin that is located inside the endothelial cells will be released into the blood, and this will cause local vasoconstriction. The logic of vasoconstriction is that it decreases the blood flow to the damaged region. Thereby, it decreases hydrostatic pressure that acts on blood vessel wall, and this prevents rupture of the blood vessel. So, it's sort of emergency option. The second step is the release of von Willebrand factor. Von Willebrand factor comes from two sources. From endothelial cells, where von Willebrand factor is contained inside the viable platelet bodies, and it's a major source of von Willebrand factor. And from platelets, where von Willebrand factor is stored in alpha granules, and it's a minor source. So the concept here is that endothelial cells have so-called viable platelet bodies that contain huge amount of von Willebrand factor. And with damage to the blood vessel, von Willebrand factor is released into the blood. In the bloodstream, von Willebrand factor binds to exposed area under the disrupted endothelial cell, and it's basically a basement membrane. Basement membrane consists of collagen, and subendothelial collagen suits von Willebrand factor perfectly. So von Willebrand factor immediately binds to exposed subendothelial collagen of the basement membrane. The function of the von Willebrand factor is to serve as a bridge between the site of injury and platelet. So basically, von Willebrand factor provides the opportunity for platelets to bind to subendothelial collagen. The third step called adhesion. Adhesion is a process when platelets, by a specific receptor GP1B, bind to von Willebrand factor, and this results in binding of platelet to the site of injury. So platelets come to the site of injury, and by the specific receptor GP1B, they bind to von Willebrand factor, and exactly this simple step called platelets adhesion. The final stage of primary hemostasis called aggregation. Aggregation is basically accumulation of a lot of platelets in one local spot. The key event in aggregation is binding of fibrinogen to GP2B3A receptor on platelets. During aggregation, platelets become activated, they degranulate with release of ADP and thromboxane A2, and this results in formation of a platelet plaque. So after the adhesion, platelets become activated. In response to this, they undergo shape change that results in their degranulation. With degranulation, platelets release the content inside them, including the dense granules that contain ADP. ADP that is released into the blood acts on ADP receptor on platelets and activates it. This receptor, also known as P2Y12 receptor. Activation of ADP receptor induces platelets to express a specific receptor called GP2B3A. The logic behind this is that GP2B3A receptor is essential for platelets aggregation, but in passive state, this receptor is contained inside the platelets. Only activation of ADP receptor forces platelets to transport this receptor to their surface, where GP2B3A receptor serves as binding site for fibrinogen. In addition to this, platelets from prostaglandins by COX enzyme begin to produce thromboxane A2, and the function of thromboxane A2 is to promote aggregation. The key molecule in aggregation is fibrinogen. Fibrinogen is a protein that is produced by the liver and is always present in the bloodstream. Fibrinogen serves basically as a fishing net. It catches platelets and gathers them together. So if only fibrinogen noticed a GP2B3A receptor on platelets, fibrinogen immediately binds to GP2B3A receptor, and when another platelet comes to the site of injury, platelet immediately binds by GP2B3A receptor to fibrinogen. And important that this process is significantly accelerated by thromboxane A2. This binding occurs over and over again until platelet plaque will be formed. And exactly this gathering of platelets at the site of injury called aggregation. But this process occurs in a hurry, so this platelet plaque is sort of emergency option. And the major drawback of platelet plaque is that it's quite unstable and weak. And in order to stabilize platelet plaque, we have secondary hemostasis. The function of the secondary hemostasis is to make from weak platelet plaque a formidable structure that called thrombus. And the thing that makes this platelet plaque formidable is conversion of unstable fibrinogen into a stable fibrin. Secondary hemostasis is provided by coagulation factors that form coagulation cascade. Secondary hemostasis can be divided into intrinsic and extrinsic coagulation pathways, and activation of coagulation cascade results in formation of a thrombin that provides conversion of fibrinogen into fibrin, and this makes weak platelet plaque a formidable thrombus. The central factor of coagulation cascade is factor 10. The goal of both intrinsic and extrinsic coagulation pathways is to activate factor 10. Intrinsic pathway consists of factors from 12 to 8, and obviously we skip factor 10 because, as we said, this factor we have to activate. Extrinsic pathway consists of just factor 7. Activation of factor 10 results in activation of factors 5, 2, and 1. It's easy to remember because 5 times 2 is 10 and 2 times 1 is 2. Factor 2 called prothrombin, that with activation becomes thrombin. And factor 1 called fibrinogen, and with activation fibrinogen becomes fibrin. And exactly fibrin makes from platelet plaque a formidable thrombus. So to repair the damage, initially primary hemostasis has to make a platelet plaque. And then the secondary hemostasis has to make from platelet plaque a formidable thrombus that can cover the damaged area until the damage will be repaired. And it's the entire logic of our coagulation system. If you like content, please press like and subscribe button. All the best!